Good morning and welcome to the Lighthouse Church. It's such a great morning to be with us because it's Christmas Day. We are so excited that you can be spending this time with us this morning. We have a short message, we have a short worship song, and we have some prayer. But on top of all of that, we have Jesus Christ our Lord this morning. Not in a manger, but in our hearts. So let's celebrate, let's worship, let's get into the service, and let's give this time to Jesus this morning. Merry Christmas.
Luke chapter 2. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger, because there was no guest room available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
So this morning we continue the account that we started 2 weeks ago, found in Luke 2, as we look at the birth of Christ. And this is the continuation of part one. So if you want to have the backdrop to where we're going, when you have time, I appreciate you're going to be incredibly busy, it's Christmas, then do so. You can find that on our website. And we're just going to rejoin that message that we started. We're going to continue the journey. We're going to continue that story. And we're going to look today at the birth of Christ on Christmas Day. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah. He is the Lord. But before we get ahead of ourselves, we've gone to verse 11 and we're going to go back to verse 8. And we go and we see these shepherds, they're in a field. They're doing the daily duty. They're doing the daily job. They're doing the daily grind. They're not in a church. They're not on a mission trip. They're not even at a conference. They are in a field. They are shepherds simply doing life. Verse 8 reminds us that God is not limited to our expectations of him. His will, his ways, his plans. They often challenge our view of him. They always expand our faith in him. And they will categorically always reveal truth about him. And the simple fact is, just as these shepherds found out, God meets us where we are at. But he calls us to where he is. God is still providing opportunities. God is still providing signs for mankind, people like you, people like me, to follow him today, to experience him today. An opportunity to see Jesus for yourself. So as we build a picture of what a shepherd looked like, what a shepherd was, what a shepherd did in these times, it's really important we look at the manners and the customs. So in Christ's day, the average shepherd, just like you would have seen in that picture, he would have been at the bottom rung of the Palestinian social ladder. He would have shared the same unenviable status, I guess, as a tax collector. So he would not be well respected. He would not be well thought of. In fact, when you look at the manners and customs for this time, he would have been deprived of his civil rights. They would have been ridiculed. They would have been mocked. They would have been despised. Shepherds were low. And then we got the scene that we read in this account. Angels appearing to lowly shepherds to announce the birth of a king. And when you think about it, it is just an audacious story. But isn't everything a little audacious when God is involved? However, when we read about shepherds, in books like this, in Manners and Customs, we begin to understand the context and the backdrop of what we're reading. There is also an alternative, non-traditional view of what we've come to know about this story. So in the Manners and Customs book, it explained, this was also a time where there was Levitical shepherds, they were priestly shepherds, that would basically charge with rearing the temple flock. Now these sacrificial sheep, they were reared around the same time as peak festivals such as the Feast of Tabernacles, and these are all around the same time of when Jesus was born. History tells us that these Levitical shepherds were paid by the temple, and they worked just outside of Bethlehem in a place called Migdal Eder. You might have recalled when we did part one, when we talked about the messianic prophetic scripture found in Micah 5 verse 2. Well, just before Micah chapter 5 verse 2, in Micah 4 verse 8, Migdal Eder is referred to. It's referred to as Tower of the Flock. And this is significant because Migdal Eder means watchtower over the flocks. So when we cast our minds back to verse 8 and we read that again, it said there were shepherds keeping watch over the flocks at night. As we look into the Manners and Customs and we look at Levitical shepherds, it's interesting and it's noteworthy that we recognize they were well versed in the practice and the significance of birth and sacrifice, and the details that are surrounding what they would later see at the birth of Jesus would not be missed on these particular shepherds. Levitical shepherds would ensure a safe, clean birth for the lambs. They would wrap that newborn lamb in swaddling cloths, like Jesus. They would keep them clean and they would keep them protected until the time of sacrifice. As we move on in this account, we come across the angels affirming certain details, certain descriptions of what these shepherds should look out for. And now these certain moments, these certain signs will categorically, beyond a shadow of a doubt, affirm to them what they are about to see. But they still have a choice, these shepherds. They have to choose to listen to the angels. They have to choose to act. They have to choose, in the busyness of their lives, to go find Jesus. These shepherds, they had a choice to make when they were given the details by the angels. And I've heard it said through the years, I don't know how you can believe. And my answer is always the same. How can I not believe? The God of heaven and of earth, the God of all creation, the God of the Bible, He spoke to me in a way that I could personally understand Him, and in a way that I could personally receive Him as my personal Lord and Savior. Our Lord, our Savior, He gets personal. He knows how to get your attention. He knows how to make it real to you, even if it sounds like a mystery to everyone else. Even in the account that we've read today, the shepherds got it because the details were specified. They were specific to them. And that's what I love about God. He colours in the details of our experience so that we can see Him. But do we always follow the signs that lead us to Jesus? So let's look at a few of the signs that we can read in this account that led the shepherds to Jesus. So verse 11 says, today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. Firstly, look how intentional you is used in this scripture. A Savior has been born to you. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. The angels wanted the shepherds to see. They needed the shepherds to understand. They wanted them to receive a personal revelation. But information without revelation just makes straight up religion. And Jesus didn't come to offer a religion, praise God. He came to offer himself that Christmas day so that we could know him, so that we could love him, and that we could experience him fully. Notice in this scripture that the angel did not say that he is in Bethlehem. He said he was in the town. He was in the town of David. And I believe that this detail is so significant because the angels wanted to shift the focus from the place and onto a royal bloodline. So remember when we did part one, we had the detail that Joseph belonged to the house and the bloodline of David. And we discussed in some detail the embroidery, the swaddling cloths that Jesus would be later wrapped in, that would be sporting the stitching of the Lion of Judah, as was the custom of the day. So a significance as great as this would definitely not be lost on these temple shepherds, whose daily jobs it was to ensure that every detail of the birth and the care of a newborn sacrificial lamb was adhered to, even down to the swaddling. And when these shepherds, they got to Bethlehem, and we did in part one, Bethlehem means house of bread, they approached a baby lying in a manger, just as the angels had said, and his name was Jesus. And we know the name Jesus, it means to save, to rescue, a savior. And this baby wasn't just lying in the arms of a mother, he was lying in a manger. And he was lying with swaddling cloths around him that bore the Lion of Judah, as were the customs of the time. All of these significant details, all of these signs were not missed on these shepherds as they followed after what the angels had told them. They had a revelation, and that revelation was received by them. Now this revelation has been fulfilled in them. And now this prophecy of the birth scene of Christ is illuminated for all to see. Verse 12 says, "This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Jesus the Messiah, he was here. And as we move through this account, I want to get to verse 17 next. But before we do, I just want to stop off at verse 14, because I've recognized as I prepared this message for this morning, there was a little detail in there that I just wanted to share. "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." If you want true, and you want lasting, and you want eternal peace that just goes beyond your earthly understanding, this morning I want to tell you it is available. It can be found. And it's offered as a gift by Jesus today, if, as this text says, his favor rests on you. So now we move into verse 17 to 20 as we bring this thing to a close, as we bring the Christmas story to its finale. "When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which are just as they had been told." So in verse 17, we have the first ever evangelists for Jesus. When they had seen him, on receiving a revelation of who Jesus was, for experiencing him and seeing them themselves, they told others about their encounter. Notice also in the text in verse 18, it says, "All that heard them were amazed at what the shepherds said to them." All. The very fact that people were listening to these shepherds, it showed that they respected them. And if people were listening to them, it was unlikely that these were just ordinary shepherds. what we know from history and what we know from books like this one, the Manners and Customs book, people will not be queuing up to listen to or be near a shepherd, a normal shepherd. And they certainly wouldn't credit what they were saying. Only people of privilege and position, like Levitical shepherds, surely could draw a crowd, not disperse one. These particular shepherds, they would have had credibility with the people. They would have got all of these details that we read in this account, what they saw and what they witnessed with their own eyes, and they would have been able to communicate this information accordingly. So as we zoom out of this nativity scene, as we zoom out of the birth of Christ, we come to verse 20. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things that they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Again, as we look at the history and we look at books like this Manners and Customs book, and we begin to understand the backdrop of the situation and the circumstance that we see this nativity scene in, shepherds only had one job, and that was to look after the sheep. And that was from leading, to feeding, to tending, to protecting. Protect them from threats, attacks, getting lost, getting injured. There were so many things, so many issues that shepherds had to look out for when looking after herds of sheep and goats. And what we read in the text and what we read in the books and what we know from history, they literally lived with the sheep. They knew them by name. They cared for them by name. These shepherds would have literally lived and breathed sheep. It was their sole purpose to wake every morning to keep these sheep under control, to keep these sheep safe, to keep these sheep loved and cared for and nurtured. And we know elsewhere in the Bible, as we read, there's also shepherds called hired hands. But these were equally passionate when you read about Manners and Customs, because these hired hands, they were paid to look after the sheep. So if they didn't look after the sheep, they don't get paid. So even if they lost one sheep, they would go looking for that sheep because that would dent their pay packet. So with these thoughts in mind, to think about any shepherds abandoning their sheep to go looking for Jesus, to hunt down a baby in a manger, leaving all of these sheep and these goats to fend for themselves, it's just a very strange and unlikely, uncharacteristic move of a shepherd whose sole purpose was to exist for his sheep. However, if these shepherds were Levitical, if they were operating from a base like Migdal Eder, and they were sharing in the responsibility of an organized herding community, these shepherds could responsibly go and seek out all that they had been told so that they may witness it for themselves, and they would be able to return glorifying and praising God to resume their priestly and shepherd duties. Whatever your position on the shepherds from this nativity scene, from the birth of Christ, whether lowly and marginalized or educated and knowing, we don't have the full facts in the text. We only have key details to form an opinion. But what we do know from the account, what we do know when we read this account, is that these shepherds did something crucial. They responded. They responded to what they heard. They responded to what they saw. They responded to their experience that night. We have considered many details over these two parts of this message. But today, on Christmas Day, we have the most important detail to consider: that Jesus was born. He came to us so that we could come to him. If you have had a revelation of who Jesus is today, if you have had a revelation of who Jesus is in your lifetime, it's probably unlikely it has not come through an angelic visitation, although how amazing would that have been? But there is something much more amazing, I feel, as we consider this story, that the Holy Spirit has revealed Jesus to you, not in a manger, but to your heart, right where you were in that moment. But our job is still the same as the shepherds. Once we receive that revelation, when we receive that truth through that divine revelation, we have the same responsibility as the shepherds to check out the details for ourselves by responding, by praying, by worshiping. And for us in this time and this day, read the Bible. The details are there to minister to us, to draw us into a deeper relationship with Christ and have a greater understanding of who He is and who we are. And just like these shepherds, we need to position ourselves, once we have this revelation, to tell the good news of Jesus, not just at Christmas time, but at all times. We need to tell others about what we have seen, what we've experienced. Jesus, the living God, He's real not just for Christmas. He's real to you and me and to those who know Him every single day. And we've got a great message to tell, that Jesus no longer lives in a manger. You don't have to leave your sheep on a hillside to go find Him. You just need to open up your heart and say, Lord Jesus, would You just come in? And His Holy Spirit will come to you and will open your eyes to see the beauty and the gift of knowing Jesus this Christmas. Let's pray. Lord, we just thank You for sending Your Son, Jesus. Lord, we thank You. We thank You for Your love, for Your grace, and for Your mercy. In a world that is ever-changing, You are the constant, and You never do. You are the same yesterday, today, and forever. And we can rely on You. You are the only constant in our lives, Lord. Lord, I just pray for each one listening this Christmas that we be people who respond. Respond to Your love. Respond to the God prods. Respond to Your signs. Respond to the message of Christmas. Respond to that new life that is only found in You. Lord, help us to be those who respond to the needs around us. And let us respond to the revelation of who You are and not just consume the information of what You did. Lord, I pray for each one of us who know You as Lord and Savior, that we would, in this coming year, that we'd be able to read our Bibles and find You in the details of Your precious word. Lord, we want to discover You in the details in every area of our lives. So Lord, would You help us, I pray. In Jesus' name, amen.
Welcome, and it's Christmas. And Christmas, great time. I love Christmas. I really like Christmas. It's a great time. But this year, everything has changed. And for some of us, it's not really that much change, but for others that can't meet their loved ones, then we really feel compassion for those. And so we've been asked to do something on prayer for this Christmas message. And I believe now, with everything that's going on, that prayer is more essential now than ever before. And Pastor Drew, often says that prayer is the engine room of the church. And I totally agree with him. Without prayer, we are not going anywhere. And without prayer, how can we approach God in that prayer that we need help. And we do truly and absolutely need help at this time. So please continue to pray. Pray fervently for everything. There's so many scriptures encouraging us to pray. I could make a list that would go on for ages, but it's all in the Bible. But please pray. It's as simple as talking to God that you can ask for his help and his advice and for the guidance of the Holy Spirit. And in Jesus' name we ask. And I think at the top of our prayer list at the moment is Pastor Drew with his broken bones. And so please pray most fervently for Pastor Drew and his family, because when one loved one is hurt, the others have to care and need extra strength and extra wisdom and extra energy to care for that person. And so please pray for them, and please pray for the church. Please pray for the actual building that some call a church, but pray for the people of the church, for the finances of the church, which are at this time very difficult. And Lord, that I want to pray now, but it's what I'm going to do is ask Hazel to pray, because she's a better prayer than me. So please have a great and wonderful, perfect Christmas, but please pray and continue to pray without ceasing. That's in the Bible. Okay, bless you.
Hello, everybody. Good to see you. Well, sort of see you. And on this beautiful day, just remembering the wonder of the birth of our Savior Jesus, and how amazing that he appeared to the ordinary shepherds. And we're very ordinary today, but Jesus said he would never leave us nor forsake us. And he said, fear not, for he is with us. And nothing can separate us from the love of God. So those that are fearful about the news of what's going on in the world, and we don't need to go into it all today, but we pray, Father, Lord, we just lift up, Lord, all those who are in hospital, Father, those that are not well, Father, and we remember them today and pray, Father, for your healing hand to be upon them. And as I pray, would you lift up the people you know, your loved ones that are not well, and we pray for your healing to be upon them, Lord. And Father, we just pray, Lord, that our hearts, Lord, would be encouraged, Lord, that we would guard our hearts at this time, Father. And Father, you said that you sent forth your word and you healed them. So Jesus, we pray for a touch on all those, Lord, that are not well today, Father. And we pray for strength for those who are caring for them in the hospitals and at home, Father. And we pray, Father, for your comfort, Lord. We pray for your peace at this time, Lord. It's a time of peace, a time of joy, a time of faith, a time of love. And we just are so grateful for what you have done for us. And Lord, we want to lift up our nation to you, Lord. And we want to say, Lord, that we are sorry, Father, that we have not kept your ways, Lord, and your laws, Lord, and we have turned away, God. We pray, Father God, that, Lord, that you would heal our nation, Lord. And we pray, Father God, that people would know you in our land, Lord. We pray, Father God, that the knowledge of your word would cover this land, Lord, as the waters cover the sea. We pray for our leaders at this time, Lord, in all the decisions that they have to make, Lord. Because, Father, you said that we need to pray for them, Lord, so that by their leading, Lord, we can live peaceful lives, Lord. We pray, Father, for your mercy and your grace upon our country, Lord. And we thank you that you have an amazing purpose for our country and you have not forgotten us, Lord. We thank you, Lord, that today is the day we can light the candle of event. For Christmas Day, we can light, because you are the light of the world, Jesus. Thank you. We thank you, God, that the people living in darkness have seen a great light, Lord. And I just noticed when our lights, they just became brighter, the darker it was outside. And things seem darker on the outside, but we can shine lighter. We can shine because we've got Jesus' light within us. And we just pray that Jesus' light will shine in this world. And we would use every opportunity, Lord, that we would use every opportunity to shine for you, Lord. And we pray, Father God, for this amazing, wonderful day, Lord. And we pray, Father God, that all will have a blessed and happy Christmas, and that, Father God, everyone will have a sense of knowing that you are with them no matter how they are spending Christmas. And we just thank you that we celebrate today, Lord. We celebrate that you came to the earth. We celebrate you are Emmanuel, God with us. And 1, 2, 3, Merry Christmas,
Merry
everyone!
Christmas.